على من لا نبي بعده ولا أمة بعد أمته ولا كتاب بعد كتابه ولا شريعة بعد الشريعة. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولقد كرمنا بني آدم. صدق الله العظيم. My dear respected elders and brothers, last week at the invitation of the South African Embassy in Kigali, Rwanda, I visited that country for a few days. Today I thought that I would like to share not so much aspects of the journey, but more importantly the moral lessons that we learned from the tragedies that had occurred in that country of Rwanda. Anyone who is in touch with global events would know that some 10 years back, and even intermittently from that time onwards, there has been a genocide that was carried out there, and people had lost their lives in thousands. In fact, to be precise, something like 800,000 people lost their lives in Rwanda. Even today, when we think about this, the mind is amazed at the sheer scale of the civil war or the genocide or the massacre, whatever you want to call it, the sheer scale of what had transpired then. And one wonders, how did this happen? And also, what lessons can we learn from these type of incidents that happen in the world? Of course, the whole aspect of how it happened is a complex issue. I don't think my purpose is to make mention of the political history of Rwanda, what had happened, but just very briefly for our understanding, some background. One of the aspects that we know in Africa that perhaps people have not really acknowledged enough is the harm upon the people of Africa that has come upon the people because of colonization. And majority, if not most or many of the countries of this continent have been colonized by European and other powers. And even it is not only confined to African states, we look at what we term today as Muslim states, whether it be Libya colonized by Italy, whether it be Syria colonized by the French, whether it be Egypt colonized by the British, or whether it be Palestine even presently occupied by Israel. All these aspects had had a tremendous effect upon the people. Now when the colonizers came, one of the aspects that was quite clear, that they had not come with the intention of welfare of the people who they had colonized. There was no aspect of welfare to the people that they had colonized. They had come with one important reason, that is for their strategic welfare and material benefit and prosperity. They've only come for their own material benefit. Whether it be, you know, the British in Indo-Pak, whether it be any other place. Wherever they colonized, they plundered that land. They exploited the land. And part of the exploitation, for them to be successful in that, had to be, they had to divide the people whom they were colonizing. They had to create a system of divide so that they could rule with the intention of the strategic purpose of colonizing and exploiting and plundering the land. And this is what they had done also in Rwanda. They had created purposely to a divide and rule policy between the people so that they could carry out their strategic interest. Never had any colonizer in Africa ever have, in the true sense of the word, the benefit or the welfare or the prosperity of the local people at heart. They were only there for a strategic purpose, for their own benefit. So when they came into Rwanda, the same thing happened. They had come, they had not worried about the local people. They created schisms. They created divisions. They created hatred between the people so that they could prosper. And one of the hatreds that they picked upon was between the Hutus and the Tutsis. Prior to this, there was a tribal structure that was in place in Rwanda, a structure that was based upon a benevolent king ruling over his subjects. And of course today we look at democracy as an ideal. people don't seem to realize that perhaps the greatest amount of lives that have been lost in the world in the past century or so has been under the authority of so-called democratic regimes. Whether it be Hitler in Germany, whether it be Slobodan Milosevic in Serbia. Both were elected democratically. But be as it may, the tribal structure that was there, benevolent king, ruled over the people of Rwanda with relative peace and calm. But when the colonialists came, what they did was for the strategic purpose to create division and divide and rule. So they created the division between the Hutus and the Tutsis. And what they did was, they also together was creating between them the divisions, they created a class struggle, a class distinction. So what they did was, anyone who had 10 cows or more, cows being a barometer of wealth in that country, was taken to be a Tutsi. Anyone who had less than 10 cows was regarded to be a Hutu. And this is documented even in the museum which is in Kigali, that this is the type of class distinction they created. And one wonders sometimes with regard to our country also, whether we are going in that same direction. That now previously where the divide was between races, are we going to see in time to come the divide on the basis of class distinction and wealth? It is something that people who are in authority always got to keep in mind. And the devastating consequences this can have. Anyway, they created this class distinction between the Hutus and the Tutsis. And they managed to create division and hatred. Now in creating hatred, both sides have to be condemned and blamed. On one hand is the colonizers who have done all this, tried to create and creating the division. On the other hand, you have to blame the local indigenous people for being manipulated to the extent that they came into what the colonizers had said. Be as it may, this particular schism started running deep between the people. And there was an incident that happened in 1994, which served as a catalyst for this divisions to spring to the fore and a great amount of killing to take place. Now again, I don't want to go into the politics of the region other than to say that the president who was at that time, he was killed in the plane crash. And because of that, they used that particular incident, the extremists of the Hutu, they used that incident as a catalyst to go on to a mob type of situation of killing of the Tutsis and other people, and even moderate Hutus. It is quite amazing when we hear about the scale of the killing, what had happened. You know, firstly, at that time in April 1994, when the extreme Hutus came into power for a short period of time, what they initially did was they took over the radio and TV stations, and through that they propagated a message of hatred to kill the people whom you come into contact with, even if they are neighbors, if they are Tutsis. And even if there are Hutus who object to it, you also kill them. This was a brazen call from the media, and of course it again shows that how the media can be negative and destructive at times when it is not used correctly. And this was the message that came about, go and kill the people, from the radio and the TV. And the people came into that type of propaganda and they went into a killing spree. You know, I had previously thought that perhaps the killing had taken place in the rural areas. But it was not in the rural areas. It was actually in the cities where roadblocks were held. And under roadblocks, they used to identify Hutus and Tutsis, and they used to murder and kill the Tutsis. Sometimes they used to kill Hutus. By and large, it was Hutus killing Tutsis, but there was also many instances where it was even against that general type of principle. Another aspect with regard to the killing was that unlike other massacres and killing, which takes place many a times in broad, in the darkness of the night, this killing actually took place in open and broad daylight. So majority, if not all of the killing, took place before 5 p.m. After 5 p.m., there was very little killing. So it was done openly and defiantly to try and prove a particular point. The second thing that was there was that the third thing maybe, it was a dubious role that was played by the churches in that land. For whatever reason, the churches actually, instead of stopping, they abetted and encouraged the genocide. And of course we have documentary proof that is now well known that in one church in particular, a Catholic church, 20,000 people had taken refuge and the priest had actually collided with the genociders to have those 20,000 people who had come for a refuge in a church thinking there is a place of God, he had them actually killed, was colluding with the people who were behind the genocide. So the church's role in this was something that was very dubious. Another aspect was that the neighbors actually started killing neighbors, something similar to what had happened in Bosnia. So even if someone had lived with someone in the same street for many years, now because of the propaganda, they killed the Tutsis, they just started killing even their own neighbors. And the propaganda was so strong that even if your wife is a Tutsi killer, and even if your children had been born from the womb of a Tutsi woman, go and kill them also. One particular person in the South African embassy in Kigali told me, he said, my mother was a Tutsi, my father was a Hutu. We used to listen to the propaganda of the radio, and for several days we lived in tension, not knowing whether our father is going to turn his gazes and his hatred towards us and kill us. We didn't know what to do. So this was the situation that had happened. And the sheer scale of what had happened, when we look at 800,000 people, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, when we met him, said, to understand this, just think that in the last 10 years or last 5 years, when we talk about terrorism and loss of life, we look at 9/11. He said, imagine 3 9/11s every day for 100 days. He said, 9/11, what great amount of noise was made with regard to the loss of life. He says, 3 9/11s, this amount, 3,000 people died in 9/11, 3 9/11s, every day for 100 days, that is the amount of people that were lives were lost. He even made mention, and he said that perhaps if there was a terrorist attack, then the world would have come to our assistance. Taking the opportunity, I said that even if Osama bin Laden was behind it, then definitely the West would have intervened. But here, because there was no other strategic interest, there was no need for them to intervene. This is another blot on the conscience of the entire humanity. And this would include Muslim states also. 800,000 people died and no one lifted a finger. The United Nations commander who was then, who had actually pleaded with them, at that time, the person who was in charge of peace operations in Africa, is the present Secretary General Kofi Annan. And he pleaded with him and said, if you give me 5,000 soldiers, that's all what I need, I will be able to save this genocide and massacre. And they were, never mind, you know, giving him that, they cut from 1,000 soldiers to 200, a token presence there. And the amount of soldiers that they had sent to evacuate the foreign nationals who were there. Now, of course, the foreign nationals who were there were not for any goodwill. They were there for the sake of plundering. But the amount of soldiers that were sent were more than the 5,000 that he had requested. He said that if you even only left me with that soldiers who had come to evacuate the foreign nationals, I would have been able to avert this massacre from the means point of view. But this was the situation. It remained a blot on the conscience of humanity, and of course it's nothing that is secret. Even in the later type of George Bush, when he was campaigning for his presidency in the United States, and someone asked, would you ever commit United States forces to something, what had happened in Rwanda? He said, because we don't have any strategic interest in Rwanda, I would not commit US forces there. So again, it shows that what they have got their forces in Afghanistan and Iraq is not because of the welfare of the people, it's because of their own strategic interest. Anyone who thinks otherwise is extremely naive or extremely foolish and ignorant. And this is the situation with regard to what had happened. This is just some of the aspects with regard to what this, I'm just giving you a small background with regard to it. When you look at this, of course, the beauty of Islamic teaching with regard to ethnicity and our ethnic groups come into the fore. Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, O people, we have created you from one male and female. And we have made you into different races and tribes. It would be foolish for anyone to deny his ethnicity. It would be foolish and stupid for a person to deny that I'm an Indian or I'm a black. And there's nothing wrong with him even doing so. And he should not be even shy with regard to it. Because Allah Ta'ala says, I have created people in different races. I have created people in different ethnic groups and different races. There is nothing wrong with regard to that. Allah Ta'ala says, I have created you in different ethnic groups and different races. But what we got to understand, what is the purpose why Allah has created us in different races and groups and different tribes? It is for the sake of identification. لتعارفوا. Not that I am better than another person because I am more fair-skinned. I am better than another person because I come from Baruj Zilla. I am better than another person because I come from Surat. No, not because of that, not because of supremacy, solely for the sake of identification. Another aspect, and maybe we sacrifice the beauty of our religion. Wallah, we don't understand the beauty. When we don't practice upon it, this is what happens. You see, then Allah Ta'ala has also said, what are the boundaries with regard to your affiliation to your own race and to your own tribe? To cater or to struggle for the upliftment of your own people, there is nothing wrong with that. خَيْرُكُمُ الْمُدَافِعُ عَنْ عَشِيرَتِهِ مَا لَمْ يَعْتَمْ Said our beloved Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the best among people are those who fend for their tribe as long as they don't do wrong while fending and looking after the interests of their tribe. Nothing wrong with that. Now comes the situation, there is a parameter. How do you say your affiliation to your tribe in a manner that could be harmful to the greater interest of society? And that is where the beauty of our beloved Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's teaching is. When he said, لَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ قَاتَلَ عَلَى عَصَبِيَّةِ He is not from amongst us who fights on tribal partisanship. Wasila bin Asfar radiallahu anhu one day asked, Ya Rasulullah, mal asabiyya? What is this asabiyya and tribal partisanship that you are prohibiting us from carrying out? The Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَنْتُعِينُوا قَوْمَكَ عَلَى الظُّلْمِ You help your people upon wrong. You help your people upon wrong. So I would side with a black person because I am black. I would side with an Indian because I am an Indian. I would side with someone from my organization because I belong to that organization. That is a tribal partisanship about which Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has prohibited. You don't cooperate with people on any basis. If you want to cooperate, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى Cooperate on goodness and virtue. وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ And you don't cooperate on acts of guna and oppression. And if you get together to oppress another people, then you need to tell your own people that this is wrong. We are not supposed to oppress other people. This is the beauty of Islamic teaching. Carrying on from there. You know, after this, the great challenge for that country is the reconciliation and reconstruction. And of course, you know, one thing I must make mention is the positive role that the Muslims have played in this regard. That the Muslims had been amongst the forefront of helping people at the time of genocide. To that extent, there is a museum in Kigali, there is a narrative of a person by the name of Yahya, who kept 20 people who have been persecuted, their lives were at stake, he kept them at his home. And when he kept them at his home, the people who were after them said, hand them over to us to kill them. He said, I will never hand them over. He said, we will kill you. He said, kill me if you want. My Quran says, وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَعَنَّمَا أَحْيَا النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا He who saves one life, it is as if he has saved the whole humanity. He said, my Quran says I must save people's life. You can do whatever you want, I won't hand them over to. It is because of this, that prior to the genocide, there were 250,000 Muslims in Rwanda. And today there are 1.2 million Muslims in Rwanda. Again, it shows this whole thing that the ulama have been saying. Show your mettle by your character to the people that you come into contact with. You will see how Islam will spread. Here is an example. They showed that our Islam says you must preserve lives. They did it at the expense of their own lives. And look at how people are flocking towards Islam. This is a challenge that is out to us also that is there. And of course there are many other aspects. You know, one of the aspects of reconciliation was this, that the secretary of the Unity and Reconciliation Commission in Rwanda is a Muslim woman. And she was so extremely pleased to see myself, and she identified that you as a Muslim, could tell the Muslims that they had played a role in the genocide. Now they must play a role in reconstruction. Again, the lesson which seems to have saved South African Muslims, we might have played a particular role, but now with regard to reconstruction, we seem to be lagging behind. We need to be in the forefront, so that we can play our rightful role because of what our religion says. And she also made mention that if perhaps there was an outside force that had killed someone, 800,000 people, or an earthquake, or a tsunami, it might have been easier to deal with. But here we are dealing with people who were killed by their own neighbors, who are still in our midst. How do we deal with reconstruction and reconciliation? In a speech that I gave at the South African Embassy function of Unity and Reconciliation, I made mention of several points. I won't have time to go all of them. But I'll make mention of 2 points that I said at that time. I said, firstly, the dignity of human beings. Our Allah says, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ I have granted respect and dignity to every child of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. Today you and I, we respect people. We respect people because they are influential. We respect people because he's a lawyer, he's a doctor, he's a maulana, he's a chef. Or perhaps at last, because I know him, I will respect him. Right? Or we will respect people because of the influence. You see, that is not what Allah says. Allah didn't say respect people whom you know. Allah didn't even say respect people whom are Muslim. Allah says, I have granted respect and dignity to every child of Adam alayhi salam. Due to him being a human being, he is worthy of respect. Then I further made mention that reconciliation, Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, وَلَا تَسْتَوِي الْحَسَنَةُ وَالْسَيِّئَةُ. We sometimes in imaging with regard to Muslims, we tend to forget the beautiful teachings of Islam. Do not repel evil with evil. اِتْفَعْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. Always repel evil with goodness. فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ. In this way, the people whom you are your enemies, they will become your friends. Now, you know, just remember this ayat very clearly. And I want you to reflect on this. Allah says, repel evil with goodness and your enemies will become your friends. If your enemies are not becoming your friends, then it is because you have not repelled evil with goodness. Again, let me say it. If your enemies are not becoming your friends, it is, the Quran can't be wrong. The Quran says it, repel evil with goodness and your enemies will become your friends. Now if it is not happening, the Quran can't be wrong, then it has to be one thing. We have not repelled evil with evil with goodness, we have repelled evil with evil. And then another aspect that I made mention amongst other aspects, I said to show mercy and kindness. You and I have mistaken that to show mercy and kindness we reckon to a biology. So look at how weak he is. He just capitulated and he became merciful and he became kind and he forgave them. Mercy and kindness is not an act of weakness. It's never an act of weakness. Mercy and kindness is an act of strength. Only a strong person can show mercy. Only a strong person can show kindness. Only a strong person can be forgiving. A weak person begs for mercy. A weak person begs for forgiveness. He begs for kindness. He can't dispense with kindness. And that is why when we talk about Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's forgiveness, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was always gentle and merciful and forgiving. But when did he come to the fore? When he conquered Makkah and now he was in power and authority. When he was in power and authority, he told the people, go, I have forgiven you. The concept of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's forgiveness was always there. But when did he come to the fore? When he had power and authority. So when you have power and authority, then you be mercy and kind. When you don't have mercy, so mercy and kindness, I made mention and I say it again, is not an act of weakness, it's an act of strength, if only we can understand. So I've just made mention of one or two aspects. Wallah, there are so many other aspects that I made note of as we were going. But I think inshallah, if we just understand this, I think we will go a long way in understanding what had happened and the lessons that we can learn from that entire tragedy. May Allah give us a topic of understanding and making amal. Wa asru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.